Hey, welcome to part 2 of writing a Foundry VTT system from scratch. Today we're mainly going to focus on setting up actors and character sheets. Since it's very similar to setting up item sheets, I will fast forward through the bits I already explained in the previous videos, so you should watch those first if you haven't already. With items, it didn't take a lot of work to figure out what the data model or the sheet would look like because items are rarely more than their stats. With characters, however, it's a bit different because games often have different character types that are almost the same, but not quite. And having a good grasp of what's the same and what's different will make your life easier as a system developer. I'm going to use FengShui as a case study, but if you know exactly what you need to build, you can skip a few chapters to get to the coding part. But if you don't, keep watching and let's do a bit of planning together. First, you need to make an audit of the character types your game has. FengShui has 5 different types. Heroes, aka the player characters, bosses, featured foes, supporting characters, and mooks, cannon fodder that drops after one hit. That sounds like a lot, but let's dig deeper. The rules tell us that anyone who isn't a mook is a named character, and upon further reading, we also learn that there is no difference between featured foe and supporting characters other than their attitude towards the players, and the maximum amount of health a character has depends on their type and is different from each type. Based on that information, we can cut down our number of types to 4. We can even go down to 3 if we merge bosses and featured foes together, but that would mean making the GM manually set values that we could otherwise automate, so let's stick with 4. Now, we want to look at our most complex character type and see what they're made of. Usually this is going to be the player characters, so let's take a look at the character sheet and what kind of information is on there. While we're there, we should also pay attention to the layout, as this will be helpful when building the character sheet. Assuming that we can and want to reproduce the look of the original sheet, which I do in this case. So, we have a sidebar containing the character archetype name, it's like its class but different, a picture, a block of stats, a list of weapons, and a wealth status. At the bottom, we have a list of boxes for wound points, which have a special indicator in some places denoting impairment thresholds. It's not obvious there, but I know these thresholds can vary between classes, so I need to make a note that this will need to be a variable to keep track of. On the left-hand side, we have 3 text areas, which are essentially the character's biography. Below that, we have shticks, which are the character's special abilities, laid out over 2 columns. We have a section for additional shticks and gear, but since our list of shticks is going to be dynamic, in our sheet this would only contain gear, which are vehicles and armor. Next to that, we have the list of skills the character possesses. And finally, we have the marks of death, which tracks the likelihood of a heavily wounded character to die at the end of an encounter. So we've identified 13 plus elements we need to track for a character. Now let's take a look at examples of other types of characters and see what's different. Bosses and featured foes have a very different presentation from characters in the rulebook, but if we look closely, we can see that they have the same stats as heroes, except for fortune. They have weapons, sometimes vehicles, skills, and special abilities that, for all intent and purposes, are the same as shticks. In short, they have the same elements as heroes minus fortune and marks of death. This means that we can give bosses and featured foes almost the same character sheet as heroes. Knowing this in advance is important. And for our last character type, we can see that they share 3 of the stats with other types of characters and just have a weapon or 2. This means we'll be able to make a much simpler sheet for them. Now that we've done our homework, modifying template.json should be fairly simple. As we said, we're going to have 4 types: hero, mook, featured foe, and boss. Then, there are a few templates that we can create. We know that all character types share some stats, so we can create a common stats template. And this is where we need to talk about grouping attributes or not. The simplest thing for me to do here is to add a field for attack, defense, and speed. If you've looked at the D&D 5e system, you will have seen that the stats are grouped under abilities and have a field for the value. D&D 5e does this for specific reasons that might not apply to your system. So consider the usage before copying this format and making yourself do more typing than necessary. 5e does it this way because for each ability, there are several pieces of interesting information. If in your system this is just a number, you don't have to nest the value one level deeper. As for grouping, it depends on what is making references to those properties. In 5e, things like skills, spells, saving throws are based on an ability. If all your abilities are neatly grouped in the same dictionary, it can make it easier to refer to them as a group, for instance in a dropdown to select which ability to use for determining the DC of a saving throw. If you don't need any of that, you can make your model flatter, which is what I'm going to do. I mentioned in a previous video that characters can have up to 2 attack stats, and that the name of these vary depending on the archetype. So I'm going to call these stats attack primary and attack backup, and I'll have to have a field for the name. We already defined what those names would be when we made the weapon sheet, so I just need to decide on default values. The most common combo is guns as primary and martial arts as backup. However, mooks only have one attack type as opposed to named characters, so we'll move that backup attack in another template in a bit. Then we add speed, defense, and a text property for the character concept, which will serve as description for NPCs. Next, we can make a template for named characters. This is where we're going to put the backup attack. Named characters have an extra stat for toughness, and they also have wounds. In this case, we have 2 subvalues for wounds: the maximum of wounds a character can sustain, and how many they have sustained so far. If you have an attribute with a property named value and another called max, Foundry will recognize this as a resource, which you can display as a bar on tokens. Named characters have impairment, which kicks in after a certain number of wounds have been sustained, but can also be gained from various events in the game. While there are 2 thresholds, the second one is always 5 points after the first one, so we only need to put 1 in the template. We need to leave a field for any extra impairment point gain, and we'll calculate the total in code. These are the only templates we need, so now we can create our actor types. Mooks are pretty simple, as they'll just reference the common template. Feature foes are the same as named characters, however they have a different max health. So what we can do after adding the templates is to simply overwrite the properties we want. We're going to do the same for bosses. And now we're just left with heroes, which do have a few more things to them as we've seen in the character sheet. And that's it, our actors are done. You can see how a bit of preparation made this work quite simple. Let's check in Foundry that they're all showing as expected. While we're here, we'll create test actors to open the sheets later. Now let's create sheets for named characters. The setup for the code is the same as with item sheets, so I will whiz through that. The only difference is that we're going to use actors.registersheet instead of items, and that our sheet class is going to extend actor sheet instead of item sheet. Note that if there's only one main template this sheet is going to use, you can set it in default options rather than having to override the template getter. Don't forget to update the CSS classes. The most observant among you will have noticed that my template files have changed extension to an .hbs. This is because I discovered that VS Code has an extension for doing syntax highlighting on handlebars templates, which makes reading them a bit easier. Okay, now we're on to the main course. In the interest of keeping this video at a reasonable length, I'm not going to go into every detail of the sheet, as most of it is the domain of standard web page design and building, but I'll get through the sidebar of the character sheet as it will illustrate most of the Foundry-specific concepts. First, we're going to add a div element to contain our sidebar and give it a class called sidebar. The first element of our sidebar is the archetype info. Normally you just put an input box in there, but I want to do something special here. First, the text for archetypes might be quite long and need to be displayed over several lines, which the input tag is apparently unable to do. So instead, I'm going to put our text inside a div and set it to be content editable. The second thing I want to do is not display this on NPC sheets. So I'm going to wrap the whole thing in a handlebars if, checking if the actor is a hero. Next, we have the actor's portrait. Nothing special here, just doing the same thing as in stock sheets. After that, we have a stat block and a list of weapons. We can see that they share a background, so we should probably make a div for the lot. Here, we're going to make use of a handlebars feature called partials, which allows us to inject the content of another handlebars template in our page. Partials are used for repeatable pieces of HTML, as well as for breaking down the page in more manageable chunks. We'll create the file in a moment, but for this to work, partials need to be registered. Back in our main system JavaScript file, we're going to create a function called preload handlebars templates, in which we'll create a list of paths to the partials we want to register, then call a Foundry function called load templates, which will register and cache the partials for us. Obviously, we need to call that function somewhere, and we'll do that in the init hook. The 5e system puts the preload handlebars templates function in a separate file. I'm doing it in the main.js file for brevity. Okay, back to creating our partial. I went ahead and pre-made this. If you remember part 1 of the series, there isn't really anything new to it. While we're not going to do a huge amount of styling in this video, we already know looking at our original sheet that the stat name and the stat values have different looks, so we might as well start adding CSS classes now, and we might need them anyway to tidy up our layout. Back to the character sheet, next up we have a list of weapons. Since weapons are one of many types of items an actor can own, we need to do a bit of filtering. The best place to do this is in the actor sheet's get data function. This is a reminder that you can augment handlebar's context object with whatever information you want. So I'm just going to add a weapons array, which is a filtered copy of the actor's owned items, only containing the weapons. Back to our sheet, I can now iterate over that list of weapons, for which I'm going to create another partial, which I'm going to call weapon card. Here, we're introducing a new feature of partials where you can change the context for the partial. In this case, I'm making the weapon be the context. Inside our weapon card, we're going to split our partial into two divs, one for the name and one for the stats, to match the original sheet layout. Then, wrapping the whole thing into another div to make it self-contained. Some of the properties weapons have are represented by icons. If the weapon's pump action property is true, we need to display the image of a shotgun shell, which is pretty straightforward. This curls, however, indicates the bonus this weapon gives against mooks. So we need to display as many of those as the value of the property. Unfortunately, handlebars doesn't come with a simple for loop helper, but that's okay because we can make our own. I'm going to skip ahead and continue as if the helper existed, as it will be easier to make sense of the code that way. This is a simple function that will repeat the content n times, in this case n being the value of the weapon's bonus against mooks. The helper creation happens in our system init function by calling the function handlebars.registerHelper. The first argument is the name of your helper. I'm going to call this one times. The second argument is a function describing what you want your helper to do. That function then can have several arguments, but the last one is a special one. Here I've called it content. The way helpers work is that they expect you to return some HTML content. So here we're just doing a simple for loop where we concatenate the result of content.fn n times. Content.fn essentially means output the content of the HTML within this helper. So it's repeating this image tag n times. Then we return the whole thing. With this, the weapon card is done for now. The last thing this sidebar needs is the wealth selector, but this doesn't contain anything we haven't discussed before. Let's see how this all looks in Foundry. As suspected, not pretty. We'll have to drag and drop a weapon to see how that works as well. Still not pretty, but it is functional. I can do a bit of tidying up in CSS, but I'll do that in the background as there is nothing specific to Foundry. I'll just point out, to make things easier to manage, I like to make one .less file per partial, and I also always split the rules so that those defining the content of the partial live in their own file, while the rules that define how the partial is laid out in the sheet lives with the rules for the sheet. I'm not going to show the construction of the rest of the sheet, because it's either standard HTML CSS that has nothing to do with Foundry, or it's stuff that we've already discussed. But since I don't want to leave you on your own to draw the rest of the OWL, I'll share some of the resources that helped me get there. Well, Google is usually the first port of call, but the same websites tend to come up again and again in the search results. First is the Mozilla Developer Network, or MDN. It's a very useful reference to see what options are available for a given CSS rule, or what's the difference between certain HTML elements, etc. You also often find results from W3 Schools, which serves a similar purpose as MDN. Apparently, it used to have a bad reputation for being inaccurate, but I hear those issues have been addressed now. If in doubt, just double-check MDN. The other site that's been mega helpful is CSSTricks.com. In particular, I refer to the guides to Flexbox and Grid all the time because I will probably never fully remember that stuff. And apparently no one else will because you can buy posters for those. So that's all I have for you today. Next time we'll do more work on the character sheet, but going back to more Foundry-specific concept. See ya!